From the St. Francis Yacht Club in San Francisco, this is the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon, hosted by Ron Young.
Welcome to the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon, live from the virtual grill room of the St. Francis Yacht Club. We hope that you and your family are sheltering in place in a comfortable environment, and we look forward to greeting you back in the Yacht Club just as soon as conditions permit. Speaking of conditions, the condition of our Earth is a big deal to many of us who sail, and anybody who's spent any time yachting is looking at the water with new eyes over the last couple of decades. Our guests today are with San Francisco Baykeeper, and their job is to be sure that the bay stays as healthy as possible. We're very thankful for their attention. Ben Eichenberg is staff attorney for Baykeeper and began his boating career in Woods Hole, Massachusetts, fishing with the family. And John Rosenfield is chief scientist with San Francisco Baykeeper, who began his boating world on a canoe in the Catskills. These are pretty idyllic environments. We've all heard so much about both Woods Hole and the Catskills. Welcome to the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon, Ben and John. So a lady who was a volunteer colleague with me on the Mill Valley Soccer Board, I was president of it for several 3 years, and Marcia Mather Thrift was an early executive director of the San Francisco Baykeeper, and I was enthusiastic about her activities to keep the bay healthy back then. So we're looking forward to your presentation on your mission and what you guys are doing to keep the bay healthy.
Great. Thanks, Ron. I'm John Rosenfield, senior scientist with San Francisco Baykeeper. And of course, I'm here with Ben Eichenberg, our staff attorney, to talk to you about how San Francisco Baykeeper defends San Francisco Bay from unsustainable water diversions. We've been on the water for 33 years using science, advocacy, and law to hold polluters accountable and stop destructive activities in San Francisco Bay, because this is our home. We use investigations, including patrols of the bay, on the bay with our patrol boat, science, advocacy to management and regulatory agencies, education and outreach, and sometimes litigation to defend the bay from the biggest polluters. We've done an analysis of the biggest threats to the bay, and we prioritize our actions based on the biggest threats and the tools that we as Baykeeper have to combat those threats. And so our focus is highlighted here in these bullet points. We prioritize restoring fish and freshwater flows. That's what we'll talk about today. But we're also focused on preventing oil disasters. There's a picture here of the Costco Busan, which some of you may remember, ran into the Bay Bridge many years back, spilled a lot of oil. Baykeeper was on the scene when that happened. We hold industry accountable. We're promoting rewilding of our shorelines. We're taking on dealing with toxic sites in advance of rising sea levels, because those toxic sites are going to be inundated by a rising bay level. We're fighting to keep the bay blue, which means combating eutrophication, or having the water turn green because there's too many nutrients in the bay's water. Curbing urban slobber, which means combating the effects of stormwater runoff from our cities. And protecting the bay's bottom, a part of the bay that most people don't think about is the sediments and life on the bottom of the bay. But that part of the bay is important to the functioning of the whole bay. So as I mentioned, we're here today to talk about our work specifically on protecting fish, fisheries, wildlife, and communities from unsustainable water diversions. Where does the bay's fresh water come from? I mean, I've mentioned now that we're using this water unsustainably. So let's take a big picture view of what that water supply is and where it comes from. The Bay's Central Valley watershed covers about 40% of the state's land area. So on the right, I'm showing a map of Northern California, Northern Central California, and the area highlighted in green is the Bay's watershed. Storm runoff or snow melt from within that green area all comes down through the delta, which is highlighted in yellow there in the middle, and flows into the bay, at least theoretically. The this water flows through a huge set of rivers, many of the names of which will be familiar to you all. The main tributaries are the Sacramento, which flows from the north to the south, draining the Cascades and the Northern Sierra, and the San Joaquin River, which is flowing from the south to the north, draining the Southern Sierra. And then there are many tributaries, are names that should be familiar: the Feather River, the Yuba River, American River, and the McCalmie, the Stanislaus, and Tuolumne and Merced rivers flowing into the San Joaquin. So it's a huge area, and this is a lot of water, as you can imagine, draining all of the Sierra, the western slope of the Sierra Nevada and Southern Cascades. And all of this fresh water has a huge effect on the ecosystem of San Francisco Bay. Some have called freshwater flow into the bay the dominant variable, the master variable that controls a lot of other parts of the ecosystem, the physical attributes of the ecosystem. So for instance, timing and volume of freshwater flow into the bay is what makes the bay an estuary. An estuary is a special kind of ecosystem where freshwater mixes with salt water and forms this brackish water interface that certain organisms specialize in, and that's very dynamic and really is very productive of lots of abundant kinds of life. So one of the major effects that freshwater flow has on the bay is the distribution of salinity. And so these graphs show that 1983 on the left is a very wet year, and 1988 on the right is a very dry year. 1993 is kind of a middling year. The blue coloration in the graphs in the bay shows the extent of fresh water, and the red coloration shows the extent of marine water in the bay. So in 1983, a very wet year, large swaths of the bay were completely fresh. And even Central Bay was probably fresh enough that you could drink it without tasting the salt, right? Very low salinity. But in 1988, when there wasn't much flow from the Central Valley's, from the Bay's Central Valley watershed, the fresh water recedes, the salt water encroaches, the ocean, basically the bay becomes part of the ocean. And that's what you see in the graph or in the image on the right in 1988. Most of Central Bay is basically indistinguishable from the Pacific Ocean for an aquatic organism. So that's the effect of freshwater flow on salinity distribution. And obviously fish and wildlife care about the salinity of water they're in. It affects their habitat.
We sailors pay attention to the flood and the ebb of the current because they can provide an advantage or disadvantage when racing in San Francisco Bay. And some of us keep track of something called net delta outflow, a term I learned 30 or so years ago. Do you have any metrics that you could associate with each of these 3 years that we see here? It looks like there's obviously way less net delta outflow in 88 because there's apparently the flood goes farther up or the salt water goes farther up the system. So are there any metrics that you could associate with these graphics?
You mean in terms of the net delta outflow in these years?
Yes.
I would have to look, but you can assume that 1983, there's orders of magnitude more freshwater flow than 1988. I mean, that's one of the attributes of the bay, and it graphs that I'll show in a minute, we'll be able to see that there's a huge variance in the amount of water that comes into the bay. Very, very.
So the left to right graphic, while not chronological, does show increasing salinity on the right hand graph. So you've organized these by less net delta outflow going left to right, less and less as you go to the right.
That's
okay.
Correct.
Got it.
Yep. So flow also affects the temperature of the Delta and Suisun Bay in particular, water temperature, water clarity in terms of the amount of sediment that's carried from the Central Valley into the bay, currents, obviously of importance to the yachting audience, water residence time, or how long does freshwater stay in the bay before it makes its way out of the Golden Gate. I've talked about the sediment transport, but the thing we're going to talk about today is the effect of freshwater flow on the abundance and distribution of fish, wildlife, and invertebrates in the bay. So there's a lot that I could go into here, but again, freshwater flow is really the dominant variable affecting the fish and wildlife of San Francisco Bay. This chart here just shows a number of species that are affected by freshwater flow, that have statistically significant relationships with freshwater flow that are positive. The more flow that comes into the bay, the more of these fish you can expect to see. And that includes Chinook salmon, striped bass, sturgeon, smelt species, flounder, all the way down to shrimp, which the fish use for food. So each of these species has a significant correlation with freshwater flow into the bay in terms of their abundance. But otherwise, these fish and wildlife species have very little to do with each other. Some are native, some are non-native. Some live just 1 year, like the Delta smelt. Some live for decades, like green sturgeon. Some of these species are resident, some are migratory, and some reproduce in freshwater, some reproduce in the ocean. So they don't have much in common with each other. What they do have in common with each other is that they live in water and that their abundance is correlated with freshwater flow from that Central Valley watershed into San Francisco Bay.
So I have a question. Striped bass are not native, it says in your graphic. That's interesting.
Yeah, technically not native. They were introduced in the mid-1800s, mid to late 1800s, intentionally introduced. And so, you know, if you're a purist, then they're native. They came from the East Coast. They're common and native in East Coast rivers and estuaries, and were introduced here as a sport fish.
What does this term anadromous mean?
Anadromous means that they migrate, that they spawn in freshwater and migrate to the ocean and then return to freshwater to spawn. So Chinook salmon are a classic example of that.
So they need freshwater to spawn is what you're saying.
Exactly. Okay, so we have a lot of freshwater. Where does all of it go? Because I've mentioned that we use this water unsustainably.
I'm glad you're addressing this issue. We've been asking people about the peripheral canals and how they've diminished net delta outflow for decades on the Wincyonic Luncheon. And many times people just sort of dodge the issue, and they tell us that those canals we see when you fly down to LA or across the Central Valley are not really peripheral canals. Tell us all about the peripheral canals.
The graphic on the right that I'm showing is the beginning of some of the canals you're talking about that go from the Delta and take water, fresh water, down south to the San Joaquin Valley or to Los Angeles. They grab water from Delta, that area that Ben is circling now, the CVP, SWP pumps, and Clifton Court Forebay, which is in the southern Delta, out near Tracy is the okay. Nearest town.
Near Tracy. So they grab water from the San Joaquin River? Not the Sacramento?
Well, they grab water from the Delta. The San Joaquin flows into the Delta right nearby. And so they grab all or more than all of the San Joaquin's flow. And also they're designed to draw water across the Delta from the Sacramento, which is a much bigger supply of water. So again, on the left, the image that I'm showing is the Central Valley of California with its tributaries. That's the highlighted part. And then the inset is the Delta, showing where these canals emanate from. But the canals and the pumps that feed the canals are just part of a system of dams and diversions that include state and federal dams and diversions, but also private dams and diversions or municipal dams and diversions. California has over 1,400 major dams, is the point, and tens of thousands of water diversions. We use a lot of water.
So our yacht club, St. Francis Yacht Club, has a island called Tinsley Island. We've been watching it for years, and we pay lots of attention. What I call the peripheral canal were terms used back in the 60s and 70s to divert water from the Delta. You're thinking of the new tunnels as a new peripheral canal, but those of us old enough to remember the 60s and 70s, remember that the first canal started drawing water from the Delta back then. And we've noticed a difference in the salinity, and we've noticed a difference in just the amount of flow through the Delta. So I'm eager to hear all the metrics you can associate with this diversion.
So this gets to your question and your observation, Ron, about the freshwater and how much we divert. The graphic that I'm showing on the left, the vertical axis is water volume in terms of millions of acre feet. An acre foot is an acre of land covered to a foot in depth of water. That's the volume. So we're talking millions of acre feet that would flow into San Francisco Bay. And this is measured in tens of millions of acre feet, right? So a lot of water. And the graphic here shows the top of the gray bars is the volume that would flow into San Francisco Bay if no water was diverted or stored upstream. Theoretical, right? Because we do divert water and store it upstream. But this is the amount of water that falls in that Central Valley watershed and would become runoff. And you can see that it's very variable, right? It goes from lows of less than 10 million acre feet to highs approaching 80 million acre feet, right? This graphic then shows on the bottom, the aquamarine coloration is the amount of water that is stored or diverted upstream of the delta, right? This includes Hetch Hetchy large dams to the south and water that's diverted from them before it reaches the delta. And that is a large amount of water. But then you see this very bright green set of bars start carving away at the gray, bars, beginning in the late 50s and getting bigger in the late 1960s and beyond. And that's the effect of those canals that you're talking about, Ron, the Central Valley Project's main canal and the State Water Project's main canal come online in the 50s and 60s. And so that very bright green is the amount of water that's diverted from the Delta by state and federal water projects.
That water goes to Southern California largely? Where does that water go?
It's going to Southern California cities, but also partially to the Bay Area. San Jose gets part of its water from the Central Valley Project. Also the water is going to agriculture in the San Joaquin Valley, right? The Southern Central Valley is the valley of the San Joaquin River. And if you've driven down the I-5, you've seen huge swaths of almond orchards and or table grapes in that area. That's what's being grown with that water. So the pie charts at the bottom of the graph, you know, reduce this change to, you know, a few chunks from the 1930s to 1950, about 3/4 of the water that would flow to the bay actually made it to the bay. 77% is the gray area in the chart, and the rest was stored or diverted upstream. This is before the Central Valley Project and State Water Project canals and pumps started diverting water south.
Let's talk about that. The gray that you call the bay inflow, 77% on the left pie, is that water that goes from the mountain system and the rivers out the gate, or what is that?
That's the amount of water that comes from the Central Valley watershed and makes it into the bay. Once it makes it into the bay proper, it's not diverted for any other use because it's salty, right? So people wouldn't use it.
Okay, this is the fresh water coming out of the river system and going through into the bay, which means out the gate. Okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
Right. And then as we go into the 1950s to mid 1970s, you see that green section, that bright green section, appears in the pie chart, right?
Because okay, before we do that, talk about the blue next. What's the 23% up to 36? What's that blue mean?
That
the blue people.
The aquamarine part of the bar chart and the pie charts is the amount of water that is stored and diverted before it reaches the delta.
Dams, is that what that is?
Hetch Hetchy Dam. Fryant Dam that's diverting water down near Fresno, and the water sort of is stored in the dam and then diverted from the dam to agricultural uses or urban uses, depending on the dam. Hetch Hetchy diverts water on the Tuolumne and then sends it by pipeline to San Francisco so it doesn't reach the delta. So this is distinguishing who's taking what water, right?
So the blue is dammed water that goes for either a residential or agricultural or business use. Is that the
yes.
blue?
Yes.
Okay. And so we see more and more and more of that goes from 23% in the 30s and 40s to 36% in the far right pie chart.
Correct. The bright green is water that's diverted from the State Water Project and the Federal Central Valley Project from the Southern Delta that we were talking about before. And that those diversions, those canals come online in the middle of the last century, right? And begin pumping water from the Delta, right? So it's not, the point of this graph is that it's not all federal and state diversions from those canals we were talking about earlier, but those are the newer source of diversions that came online in the middle of the last century. And the fraction of water that they are taking increases from when they started about 6% to in the most recent 40 years, almost 20% of the entire runoff available from Central Valley rivers. Some rivers, like I'm showing in this picture on the right, this is a picture of the San Joaquin River, closer to Fresno than to the Delta. And that river ran completely dry for almost 70 years. It looked like a sandbed, like shown in this image, year round because of intensive diversions upstream of this point. The other point to make here is that the percentage of water withdrawn from what would be bay inflow, the percentage is higher in dry years than it is in wet years. You can see that in the chart where the lower the gray, lower the total bar is, the higher up on that bar the aquamarine and green bars are, because basically human demands for water don't change that much. Whether it's wet or dry, there's a huge variance between wet and dry years, but the demand for water, the water that we take from the bay, is much more stable. So basically the bay is getting the leftovers of what people don't divert for urban uses, industrial uses, and agricultural uses. And to anticipate a question, agricultural use of this water is about 80% of the water that we're diverting upstream and in the Delta is for agricultural use. 20% goes for all the other industries in California and all residential and municipal uses.
Fascinating. So what we're seeing is that the blue portion, i.e. that which has been diverted by normal organized canals and dams, now blue part hasn't changed as much as the green part. The green part has gone up 3x in the last 40 years. And as you point out, the gray or the net delta left that flows through the bay that keeps the bay clean, that gets dramatically changed in drought years, gets reduced, or in flood years gets increased quite a bit. So that's very interesting to notice. Sometimes more than half of all the water from the river system is diverted one way or the other, either the blue or the green.
Right. On average, more than half of the water that would flow into the bay is diverted in current years. But in dry years, that can be almost 3/4 of the water, or 2/3 to 3/4 of the water in very dry years. In very wet years, we simply lack the capacity to store or divert the water. And if it's very, very wet, as in 2017, for instance, people don't need as much water because their fields are flooded or their yards are flooded. So that water then can make it to the bay.
May I ask, John, you're the scientist for Baykeeper. Where did you go to school? What kind of degrees do you have?
I did my undergrad at Cornell University. I got a master's at University of Michigan, and my doctorate is from the University of New Mexico. And I also then did a postdoctoral research position at University of California, Davis.
What's your doctorate in?
The evolution, ecology, and conservation of fishes.
Wonderful. Great. Thus far, your presentation's got way more data points than previous related presentations. Thanks so much.
Sure. Thanks for saying that. So the effects of unsustainable water diversions are many. San Francisco Bay is home to 6 endangered fish species. We have collapsing fisheries. We're not producing, the Central Valley's rivers are not producing enough salmon to support the coastal orca whale population. That the orcas pictured there in the lower right are, research shows that they're starving to death because of lack of their primary food, Chinook salmon. This is a special type of orca whale that focuses only on Chinook salmon. Other orca whales focus on other organisms, but our local resident pod of orca whales specializes in Chinook salmon, and they're not getting enough from the Central Valley or other rivers of the coast. But we also see effects like increasing harmful algal blooms, in particular in the Delta, and that's related to freshwater flows into the Delta. And our wetlands that we've spent a lot of time and effort restoring are not receiving enough sediment to keep them building up, accreting in the face, in advance of rising tides, right, from rising sea levels, right? These are all effects of unsustainable water diversions. The graphs here that on the left show just for some of the species, the vertical axis is their abundance, an index of abundance. It's not their population numbers. It's just an index produced by state or federal agencies. And so the idea is to show the relative decline through time from the 1960s or 1970 through to the middle of the last decade. You can see the blue line goes from high numbers to low numbers, right? And some, like winter run Chinook salmon or longfin smelt or Delta smelt, are approaching zero. Okay, so that's the problem. But it's not just endangered species like those three up on the top graphs. We're also seeing declines in striped bass, which I mentioned are a non-native species that are a sport fish. People like to fish for them. And also starry flounder, which is a fish that rears in the estuarine nursery of the bay, but then migrates out to the ocean where it's part of a commercial fishery, and their numbers have declined over time as well.
What's that index on the left? What does FMWT stand for?
Oh yeah, that's code. That's the Fall Midwater Trawl. California Department of Fish and Game has run an annual survey in the fall months from 1967 to currently. They run nets through the water, and then they enumerate the fish that they count, and they produce an index of abundance from that.
So one of the things that I'm discovering looking at this chart is that, yes, as we have collapse of the fisheries, you're saying that there's also this negative synergy. When there are less salmon, not only do we see less salmon, have less salmon, but that causes less of other species that eat salmon, in this case, the whales.
That's correct.
And then one of the other negatives we've seen in the Delta is these big blooms, hyacinth bloom all over the Delta. The water gets green. We used to swim a lot in the Delta when I was a teenager, and now the water frequently gets that kind of greeny color. So talk to us relationship between the decrease in the fish and the increase in algae.
So the algal blooms that we're really concerned about, that Baykeeper is working on, are toxic algae. Not all algae are toxic, but there's a certain group of algae, what are called algae, that are actually a different kind of organism that emit a toxin, different organisms, different toxins. But some of these toxins can be very powerful. And so you hear reports, increasingly frequent reports, of people taking their dog to the shore and the dog jumps in to go fishing and dies. Or people getting sick from drinking water. And you'll see signs around the Delta in particular in the summer that warn people to stay away from the water because of these toxic algal blooms. And research has shown that one of the things that facilitates the growth, the blooms of these toxic organisms, is reduced freshwater flow, in particular from the San Joaquin, which, as I showed you earlier, large sections of the San Joaquin run dry. There is no flow. And so that's one of the causal factors driving increased frequency of toxic algae in the Delta. And it's a problem that can come to the Central Bay as well because of the nutrients that we are pumping into the Central Bay from wastewater.
So beginning about 20 or so years ago in the Delta, if you have a cut on your hand and you go in the water, the cut gets infected. It never used to be like that. In fact, when I was a young kid in the Bay, if you hurt your hand, we used to drag our hand in the water back in the 50s and 60s, and it would basically kind of, you know, I know this sounds crazy, but the salt water would kind of help heal a scratch. But now in the Delta, if you get a scratch in your hand, you don't want to get it in Delta water. Why is that?
Well, that's again a topic for another whole conversation that we'd be very pleased to come back and give to you. But that gets to the relationship between fresh water flowing into the Delta and how long the water stays in the Delta. I mean, it's intuitive that the greater the flow of the rivers coming into the Delta, the more of that water moves through the Delta very quickly. But if there's not a lot of flow and you've got this force of the ocean trying to, you know, the most of the Delta is at or near sea level. And so on the tide, the ocean is pushing in, trying to push into the Delta. It's the fresh water that's pushing the salt out. But if you're not, if there's not enough of that flow, the water sort of stagnates in the Delta, which again facilitates harmful algal blooms, but also keeps any of the pollutants that have accumulated in the water from the rivers or from the cities that drain into the Delta, Sacramento, Stockton, for instance, keeps those pollutants, contaminants, bacteria in that area rather than flushing them out.
Again, so in other words, when there's less net Delta outflow, when fresh water is no longer rinsing the Delta, you're saying the pollutants stay in the Delta more, and that's what can facilitate the infections that I personally have experienced. Okay, in your hand, gets your hand. Okay, got it.
So one of these species that I just showed you is the I showed you the decline of, and I'm showing it here again in this graph on the left, the abundance in this fall midwater trawl. There are other measures of the abundance of this fish. They all show roughly the same pattern. The longfin smelt has declined from one of the most abundant native species in San Francisco Bay to one of the most rare. The decline is really spectacular. And so we've gone from very abundant, a fish that used to be the base was believed to be the base of the bay's food web for things that eat fish, to a species that's now almost gone. So maybe some of you have heard about the Delta smelt because it's sort of infamous as an endangered species. The longfin smelt is a distant cousin, not the same fish, but they're both headed on this trajectory towards extinction, and both in large part because we take too much water out of the Delta and Bay before, or out of the Central Valley and Delta before that water reaches the Bay. Next slide.
So just to get this again, when water is diverted and doesn't go through the Bay, the character of the water changes. It becomes more polluted because it's not being rinsed by the fresh water, and it becomes saltier. And those two effects are causing a decrease in the healthy environment that these fish need to survive?
Right. It's really all many of those factors that I showed you in the earlier slide about the effect of fresh water on conditions in the bay. It's the salinity, it's the currents, it's the turbidity or sediment load, the water clarity that's caused by, that's affected by high flows, it's temperatures. It's really all of these effects. And different effects for different species, different effects at different parts of their life cycle, perhaps, but also the production of food species like shrimp is related to freshwater flow. So that's why I refer to freshwater flow as a master variable, right? It's not that the movement of molecules of water makes fish, right? But the movement of molecules of water affects everything about the habitat of a fish in an estuary. And so when we take more than half of that freshwater flow, it obviously affects the amount of that habitat and the quality of that habitat that exists for these fish. So just to provide an overview of longfin smelt in a nutshell, this is a species that's listed under the State Endangered Species Act as threatened. Federally, under the Federal Endangered Species Act, it's warranted for listing, but has not been listed yet. And this is something that my colleague Ben is going to talk about when I hand over the mic to him. These fish spawn and die. Fancy word for that is they are semilparous, just like salmon. They spawn once and then they die, right? They don't continue to live after spawning and spawn again. They only get to spawn once. They have about a two-year life cycle. So they're born, live 2 years, and then spawn and then die. Parts of the population migrate to the ocean. That's that word we talked about before. They are anadromous, again, like salmon, which they are distantly related to. They spawn in fresh or slightly salty water. Then part of the population migrates to the ocean and then comes back to spawn again. The spawning occurs in the delta and marshes around the bay. And the marshes around the bay, even in the South Bay, that spawning happens predominantly during wet years. In the delta, it happens every year, right? Because again, these fish have to spawn or they die. But we see more habitats for spawning open up when it's wet year, during wet conditions, right? Because then there's local runoff from creeks in the South Bay or the Petaluma River or the Napa River. So the gentleman I'm showing here is Levi Lewis. He's a researcher at UC Davis, Dr. Levi Lewis. And he's done groundbreaking research in the South Bay and throughout the bay's marshes. That image on the upper right is a bunch of longfin smelt that he's caught in El Viso Marsh. For those of you who are familiar with the San Jose area.
I was a kid, we used to catch smelt off the Berkeley Pier and other places. And some of the smelt were very big. They were like 6 inches or so long. Do you know what I'm referring to right now?
Yeah, there are a bunch of smelt that are found in the bay. Delta smelt are endemic and they're only found in the northern part of the estuary, the Delta and Suisun Bay generally. Longfin smelt, again, are spawn in the delta and around the margins of the bay when it's wet. But there are other species of smelt that are coming in from the ocean. They live mostly in ocean life or spawn along beaches in the Pacific Ocean and migrate into the bay. And all of these smelt used to be part of a commercial fishery. There are records in the 1900s of they used to be measured as part of the whitebait fishery, right? Because as you're indicating, they are edible and people used to enjoy eating them. But now numbers have declined so much for several smelt species, including longfin and delta smelt, that there's no fishery for them any longer.
Yeah, they were just endemic in the 50s. They're just everywhere.
Yeah. So a little bit more about this interesting species. They are geographically widespread. So on the left, I'm showing they range from Alaska all the way as far south as San Francisco Bay. We're at the southern extent of the species range. Longfin smelt have this big geographic range in contrast to delta smelt, which are only found in San Francisco Bay. The San Francisco estuary population is a likely source population for other populations along the California coast. So these longfin smelt can be found sometimes in other populations nearby, like Tamales Bay or Bodega Bay, but those are believed to come from San Francisco Bay, or at least occasionally be repopulated by San Francisco Bay. And as I've indicated, their reproductive success of this fish is strongly correlated with freshwater flow into the estuary. Okay, so now we're getting a little bit more complicated in the slide, but I think given what I've said before, y'all can follow this. The blue line here is the abundance index of longfin smelt, right? So, and that's the left vertical axis. And you'll see that it's the index here is not going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it's going in jumps of orders of magnitude from 1 to 10 to 100 to 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, okay? And so declines in that blue line and increases represent very big changes, right? We're not going 1 to 2, we're going 1 to 10, 100 to 1,000, 1,000 to 10,000, okay? And so this is the trend from 1967 through about 2014. Right, and the trend continues to decline after that.
What's the value of using a logarithmic scale in this case? Wouldn't it be more accurate and represent the facts to show it in reality? Is it just that it's so steep, it's frightening? I don't understand why you wouldn't want to show
that. Well, so the logarithm, I mean, not to get too deep into the math, but it's just a how big is a number on a power of 10 scale. Okay, so it doesn't change the data at all. It's not less accurate. It is an exact, precise number. It's just converted. And the reason to show it on a on this scale is because otherwise it looks like the fish just disappeared in the late 1980s, right? Because you have such big numbers on the left, right? Like the graphic that I showed you early.
Yeah, 80,000. Looks like
it looks like it goes to zero, right? And because you just can't see, you can't resolve those numbers visually because of the scale. So by expanding
it actually does. Okay, I get it.
Yeah, your point by expanding the scale, you can see the variation that occurs even when the numbers get low in the tens. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to see that variation. And the reason I want to show you that variation is to show it, how it compares to the green bars. The green bars are measured on the right vertical axis, and that is the flow, which also varies hugely by factors of 10. But the point to get from this graph is to see that when the green bars go up, the blue line goes up. When the green bars go down, meaning low inflow into the bay, the blue line goes down, right? So that's this strong correlation between freshwater flow and the abundance of the fish that continues no matter how abundant the fish are, right? Even if they get really low, you can see that they are still going up and down as flow goes up and down. And it's an incredibly strong relationship over an incredibly long time period, really. You don't see correlations like this in ecology that last 50 or 60 years very often, but longfin smelt does show this decline. And its recent average is about 99.5% less than where we started in the late 60s and early 70s. So that is just to show how sensitive this fish is to freshwater flows into the estuary, which, as I've mentioned, we're reducing by human activities quite a bit. And so now I think this is my last slide, and I hand it over to Ben to describe what Baykeeper is going to do and is doing and has been doing to protect longfin smelt, but also all the other fish that depend on freshwater flow into the bay.
Ben Eichenberg, you're the staff attorney for Baykeeper.
That's right.
Tell us about your law degree. Where'd you get it? And what's your
I went to University of California, Hastings, for my law degree, and then I got a master's in public international law at the University of Oslo as well.
So my daughter, Veronica Young McGregor, was editor-in-chief of the Hastings Law Journal. She's a fellow alum like you of Hastings. Great.
Yeah, it's great. I was an editor of the Environmental Law Journal there as well. It was a great experience.
Wonderful.
I think, hopefully what you've gotten from John's presentation is how strategically important the longfin smelt is. He led us through a discussion of its, historical widespread abundance, how important it was as a part of the food web, and that, most importantly, the direct correlation between improved outflow and that longfin smelt abundance. I think John has really, really shown that. So what that means is that if we protect the longfin smelt, what we've determined with the combination, of law and science, this is what Baykeeper primarily uses their attorneys and their scientists for, is to really evaluate these questions. How do we protect, do the best we can to protect the bay? And the way that we've looked at the longfin smelt because of its strategic importance, because of the big impact it has, because it's part of the food web, because it's such a direct correlation with freshwater flow, that if we protect the longfin smelt, then we're also going to protect a whole bunch of other species, all the ones that that John pointed out in some of those earlier slides. Chinook salmon, delta smelt, sturgeon, all of those kinds of things. Legally, that makes the longfin smelt very important. They're the most responsive and sensitive to freshwater flow. So we want to try to protect them. And so we look as an attorney at Baykeeper, then what I do is I look at what laws are there out there that might help protect longfin smelt. And the other side of this is that we're not the only ones who recognize that the longfin smelt is strategically important. So there's massive opposition to protecting the longfin smelt, and just as there's massive opposition to keeping freshwater flow in the Delta. The Trump administration was dead set against listing the longfin smelt as an endangered species in the Endangered Species Act. Basically, the longer the delay in protecting the longfin smelt, the more water can be diverted from the Delta and can be taken from the bay. And that's, you know, there's a lot of people who are very interested in keeping that water and using it to make all sorts of different products. California is the main almond supplier to the world, things like that, right? So there's a lot of money at stake here. We started, you know, this has been a project we've had for a long time. Back in 1992, Baykeeper and our partner organizations filed the original petition requesting the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service to list longfin smelt under the Endangered Species Act, partially for this very reason, for its strategic importance. In 2007, we had to follow that up with another listing petition because Fish and Wildlife had been delaying for all of these same reasons, right? They want to keep, you know, there's a lot of people very interested in keeping those diversions from the Delta so that they can build more development, so that they can grow more crops. So all the things that we do with water, right? We're trying to balance those against these ecosystems. 2009, our petition was denied. They claimed that the bay population was not a distinct species. We got that. Baykeeper went to court and defeated that. And our lawsuit then led to this warranted but precluded finding for the longfin smelt. Basically, Fish and Wildlife acknowledged that longfin smelt was a distinct population in the bay and that its listing as endangered species was warranted, meaning they know, they have the data, they have the science. As Jon has demonstrated, they have the science to show that longfin smelt is going in danger, that it will get wiped out if we don't do something about it, right? But they're still saying that they don't have the resources, that there's all these reasons for delay, so they haven't listed it yet. So so Baykeeper, you know, is continuing, this part of our whole strategic initiative. We have to keep that pressure on, and it's not just one lawsuit, it's multiple lawsuits, right? So you file the initial listing petition, then they finally agree that it needs to be listed, but they say they have to delay, so then you have to sue them to stop them from delaying. And that's kind of the cycle we're in now. There's a bunch of other actions that also impact this too. So it's not just on the Fish and Wildlife or the listing. In 2015, we sued to prevent harmful dredging in the bay. The Army Corps' dredging killed 29% of the Delta smelt population, 8% of the longfin smelt population in 2011. There's better ways to dredge that would kill fewer fish. And so we're trying to force them to use the more expensive clamshell dredging as opposed to suction dredging. So that's what that 2015 lawsuit was about, but also has to do with longfin smelt and protecting those endangered species.
So suction dredging, which is like using a vacuum cleaner on the bottom of the water to dredge and to make a channel deeper, that's much more dangerous and bad for the environment than clamshell dredging. Is that what you're telling us?
Yeah, it has a bigger impact on species. So if you've got a big vacuum cleaner under the water and you're sucking up everything in sight, that sucks up or entrains a lot more fish and organisms than if you have a big clamshell that comes down and scoops and pulls up, because that when you scoop and pull up, there's an opportunity for fish to get away or escape, and so you're not doing as much damage. And there's significant research supporting that. They know it. Everyone knows it. They acknowledge that it's safer. It's better for the fish. But they say it's more expensive and that they don't have authorization to spend the extra money.
Got it.
2016, U.S. Fish and Wildlife finally announced their intention to complete the listing process for longfin smelt. But they keep setting targets for when they're going to do it. But those targets keep coming and going. So Baykeeper in 2017, but in a separate suit, Baykeeper, in order also to protect the longfin smelt, though, partially to protect the longfin smelt, Baykeeper sued to try to stop the tunnels, which by sucking up more fresh water would have harmed the longfin smelt. In 2019 is when Baykeeper, along with Center for Biological Diversity, sued the Trump administration for failing to advance the Endangered Species Act listing process. So back to that process. In 2020, Baykeeper sued the Newsom administration for failing to comply with the California Endangered Species Act in its operations of the state water project. So again, this is all about freshwater flow. The Central Valley Project is pulling freshwater out of the rivers, out of the Delta. They're not, and they're operating that, they're not taking into account, you know, what times, you know, when they can take water out, when they should not be taking water out. So, that's another portion of our sort of strategic implementation of like lawsuits and advocacy to protect the longfin smelt. And then in 2021, which the lawsuit, which I'll talk a little bit more about, our most recent lawsuit was to force the Biden administration to protect longfin smelt again. So this is back to that same listing petition we filed in 1992. And they still haven't, you know, 30 years later, they still haven't actually listed, even though they've acknowledged that it's warranted.
Let me summarize what I think I understood.
Sure.
It isn't that you're saying that the smelt themselves are super important. It's rather that they are the canary in the coal mine. And you're saying that they may be little fish, but they have a huge effect on the ecosystem. Not only do they symbolize how it's being polluted, but also they're an element in the food web. So many other species are dependent upon these little grains of food, these little smelt that are in our delta system.
Yeah, I mean, that's part of it. I mean, the other part I think is really important is what I said about it being strategically important. So we have these tools. We have the Endangered Species Act. We have the Clean Water Act. There's regulations in place. You know, the mission of the regulatory agencies is to protect this fish, to protect the public trust resources, to protect beneficial uses, right? So these laws are supposed to protect the fish. You know, the people of the United States, the people of California have agreed that they want to have fish in their rivers. And so we have these laws to protect fish. These laws apply to Delta smelt, they apply to longfin smelt, they apply to all the fish in different ways. The longfin smelt is strategically important because of the relationship between freshwater flow and its population abundance. So it's protected the same as a lot of other fish are protected. But if we can get them to enforce the Endangered Species Act, if we can get them to protect the longfin smelt, then that will protect a lot of these other species in a way that is much bigger than just protecting one species, right? So we've targeted longfin smelt because if you protect that species, you protect this whole ecosystem. Whereas if we were just trying to protect, say, striped bass, for instance, that would protect striped bass, but it might have negative effects on some other species. It might have positive effects on some other species, but the influence wouldn't be as huge, we feel, as it is protecting longfin smelt. So longfin smelt is a strategic target for that reason as well. It's also important for the food web and all the other things you said.
That's important for you. I'm glad you've explained that because a lot of people wonder, why do I care about these little smelt? The answer is they're at the base of the food pyramid. They're very significant. I get it. Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah, and you're right. If we lose them, that's a sign that we're going to lose a lot of other things that are really important. Orca whales, salmon, all of those other species that,
okay,
that people put a high value on. So we filed suit in 2021, our most recent lawsuit, which is to sue the Biden administration. You can see some of the coverage in the Chronicle. There's the cover of the complaint. The key to this lawsuit is this warranted but precluded finding, which means the feds have already determined that this species deserves to be listed, but they just haven't done the paperwork yet, essentially. The listing process, all the groundwork we've laid to get to this point, is getting that paperwork together, getting all the findings in place, but they haven't finished it, and they're saying that they can't finish it yet. And part of that is because of what I referred to earlier, the massive agricultural interests that are firmly aligned against the listing. We've already defeated one attempt by the Westlands Water District to intervene in our case. If we're successful in this case, the next step will almost certainly involve litigation against Westlands and other agricultural water users who will be suing basically to prevent the listing of the longfin smelt and to prevent the designation of critical habitat and to keep allowing them to divert more of the fresh water that the longfin smelt depend on. Their argument, and you know, the Fed's argument in this case is that delay won't harm the longfin smelt, that there are other more urgent endangered species listing that need to be done, and they don't have the resources to do this. But they're wrong. Their own findings show that delay will be critically detrimental to the survival of the longfin smelt. And they've already delayed for nearly 30 years. So argument is they don't have a rational basis for this delay. So okay. We're looking for a court ordered date by which they will submit their listing proposal. And right now it's in mediation. If that mediation fails, we'll be arguing our case in court, and we're looking forward to that. That's where we stand now. Baykeeper's priority is to restore fish and flows to San Francisco Bay. Longfin smelt's a critical component in that. From all the things we do to protect longfin smelt, including the listing suit, to all the other things that we're doing, fighting to protect freshwater flows for a bunch of different species, Baykeeper is committed to improving and enhancing river flow and temperature conditions that fully support clean water, fish, fisheries, wildlife, and communities. The diversion of freshwater, as John said, is identified as one of the most critical threats to the bay. So that's why we're focused on longfin smelt as a key component to what we're doing. And we're evaluating the most strategic application of our limited resources to maximize the protections for the bay. And that's why we focus on longfin smelt.
So Baykeeper, how big is Baykeeper? How many employees?
I think there's about 13 of us.
Right. Okay. What's the annual funding? How much is the annual funding?
I think we're at around, this is, you know, I'm the lawyer who does the lawsuits and not as much the development coordinator, but I think we're about $1.5 million a year.
So people who wanted to give money to Baykeeper, do they go to www.sfbaykeeper? What's the website?
So here we have, you know, baykeeper.org. If we go to, hopefully you can see this, if we go to donate.
Perfect. Great. So people who want to support Baykeeper, go to www.baykeeper.org. Terrific.
That's right. Terrific. Big orange donate button right there.
Great. And you guys live on a small $1.25 million-ish budget for your 13 staff people, but you have an incredible, important role in helping to keep the bay clean.
Yeah, we're an independent nonprofit organization, counts on the support of generous donors like you guys to support our continuing fight against polluters and the most pressing threats to the bay. So we hope you guys can join us, and we hope that maybe you'll come out on the bay sometime as well. We have a patrol boat that goes out and spots polluters, and we also have a hotline. So if anybody sees any pollution, definitely give us a call, 1-800-KEEP-BAY, KEEPBAY.
Keep Bay, 1-800-KEEP-BAY. So if they see somebody pouring bad minerals or whatever it is into the water, give you guys a buzz.
Sure. If you're out there at Anchorage 9 and one of those tankers is blasting out something gross out of their ballast water, or you know, there's a big stream of soapy water, or you know, whatever it is, give us a call and we'll investigate.
Okay. How else can volunteers help you? It occurs to me that you might wish you had a mobile app that people could use to take a picture of anything that's polluting the bay and sending it to you. So if somebody took a picture with their camera, what's the email address that they'd send it to?
We can send it to info@baykeeper.org. You can also go to our website, which I showed before, to report the pollution. And that if you put your email address in there, we get it. You can also upload a photo to our website. You just go to the Baykeeper website and you go to take action. You can report pollution now. And there's a whole form here as well you can fill out and upload photos.
Great. Well, Ben and John, thanks so much for helping to improve our bay. Those of us who've been sailing in it for 60 years know that it's actually, it's gotten more polluted. I hate to say it. I know it feels like we're making small improvements, but we have a long ways to go. So I'm very thankful for the 13 folks in Baykeeper who are trying to help us keep the bay clean. And our members can donate to baykeeper.org. And if they have a question, they can call, you said info@baykeeper.org. They can send emails to you guys with questions, right?
Sure. I think our website's the best portal. I think they to do that. Right. So you can, you can find the email address on there.
Perfect. What's it, what, give me a good day, John, if you saw something good in the bay, give me a metric that you'd look for that'd be constructive.
You mean a good day from the point of view of the health of the bay, not, not for me just personally.
Yeah. Good day for health of the bay. You're a scientist.
Yeah. I mean, I would keep an eye on news stories about the health and productivity of our Chinook salmon or longfin smelt, or any of the fish that are struggling now in the bay. As I mentioned, we have six endangered fish species, and also collapsing fisheries, right? So like talk to your local fishermen, and they'll tell you whether the news is good or not good. And you can buy a local, a locally grown fish from them. And, you know, to a point that you were making earlier about, you know, these small fish and why are they important? I mean, they are important, as Ben emphasized, strategically, because they will, protecting them will protect other fish. But as I mentioned, as we were discussing, these fish used to be part of a commercial fishery, right? I mean, they used to be food for us, and we've lost that. And we can get it back because endangered means there's still time, right? So we could restore all of our fisheries, including longfin smelt, to the point where we have this local abundant food supply that really makes San Francisco, you know, a culinary destination as well as a destination for other tourism. So when I start seeing fishing for species that are currently struggling because they have now become so abundant, that'll be a good day for me.
So 3 years ago, we had a presentation by speakers about the danger of the Delta tunnels and diverting more water. It seemed to me that it was completely obvious that rather than build tunnels, which take more water away from Northern California, and especially from flushing and rinsing the bay, it would be wiser to invest in desalinization plants down in Southern California that are solar powered, that in some way advance the technology for the drought in Southern California or anywhere else, because there's use for those desalinization technologies all around the world. Is there still a big danger that these peripheral tunnels or these Delta tunnels are going to be built? What's the latest on the Delta tunnels?
The latest is that the state is continuing to propose a tunnel, one tunnel this time as opposed to two, but it doesn't really make that much of a difference, a tunnel to divert water directly from the Sacramento River to those canals that, that you see down the I-5 rather than having it go through the Delta. And as you mentioned, this will likely have very harmful effects on the Delta and on the Bay's ecosystem. But I want to emphasize that it's not just cities in Southern California. I mean, we, in Northern California, we like to talk about Southern California taking our water. And of course, that's part of the situation. But Southern California learned the lesson of previous droughts and has really emphasized local water resources. They've built local off-river dams to store water when it's wet, and they've really invested in conservation and water recycling. San Francisco, on the other hand, has not made San Francisco and the Bay Area as a whole has not made the same efforts in water conservation and have made almost no effort so far in water recycling, which is much more efficient. Both of those, conservation and water recycling, much more efficient than desalination of water, because that's incredibly energy intensive. I mean, we have this water here, we clean it up anyway. If we cleaned it a little more, we could reuse that water for all sorts of purposes and really wean ourselves off this demanding water from the Tuolumne, which is an overburdened system. So have us back and we can talk about what San Francisco can do to step into the 21st century of modern water management, because they're certainly not there right now.
I've raced in Bermuda, and they collect water on rooftops in Bermuda and put them into cisterns. And what's remarkable is how much water they save by gathering rainwater. And we in Marin County have some dams, although I think we're going to try to make the dams bigger because of the most recent drought. So yeah, we will invite you back. Jon Rosenfield, chief scientist of San Francisco Baykeeper, and Ben Eichenberg, a staff lawyer for San Francisco Baykeeper. Thanks very much for the great work you're doing. And we will have you back to speak more about the role of Baykeeper in San Francisco Bay keeping it clean. Thanks very much for joining us.
This has been a presentation of the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon.